All right, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to this morning's service. As we begin our service this morning, Pauline is going to lead the first part of our service. But let's pray as we begin. Oh God, we thank you for another day to sing praises to your name, to come into your presence and give you glory, honor, and praise. We ask for the presence of your Holy Spirit to be among us today. We ask, Lord, that you inspire us in all that we do today. May we feel your power and presence. May we leave this place transformed by the power of your Spirit. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, all. We welcome everyone present here and online. Just want to give God thanks for the grace to be here this morning. May he give all of us the grace to endure and to overcome. And those who are not here with us today, we pray that God will heal and strengthen their bodies, that they will be with us very soon. Let us continue our worship with the prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our psalm for today is Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She shall not fall. God will help her at the break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done. The desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge or fortress. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Please join in the song, The Mighty Fortress is Our God.
Oh,
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us therefore confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Moment of silence. Together we pray. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God.
Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our next song, I will bless the Lord forever. Please stand.
Thank you.
Spirit, one God,
Songs today have been so far very battle army his song is not there. You know, those great songs. The Lord, the battle belongs to the Lord, and the Lord is my shield and a mighty fortress. He's our God. A great German hymn from Martin Luther. So this morning, as I said, we are continuing our look at the armor. Paul gives us six pieces of armor in Ephesians chapter 6, and we've been at this for a while, and we will continue for another weeks or so to come, probably leading into the Christmas season or the Advent season. There are two more to go, but even after we've done the two, the two other pieces of armor, this is armor number four, the shield of faith. We will still carry on in Ephesians to the very end of the book. So this morning, the shield of faith. Paul describes faith as a shield. And of course, shield protects us from danger. He says, the shield of faith to extinguish all the flaming arrows or fiery darts of the enemy. The picture that Paul portrays for us is that the enemy is shooting arrows at us, and we are to stand against it with the shield of faith. The shield of faith protects us from being pierced through with the fiery arrows of the evil one. Now, the first thing I want to say about this is to ask the question, what are the fiery arrows of the enemy? What are these flaming arrows or fiery darts? Before we look at the question of the faith itself, Paul describes the attacks of the enemy as fiery arrows. Why? Because, of course, they seek to destroy us. These fiery darts, fiery arrows, are anything that the devil uses to weaken our faith. Now, we all have weaknesses, because let's face it, we are humans, and that we all have weak areas in our lives, and the devil knows our vulnerability, probably even more than we do. And he will attack us there, at that place where he knows we are weakest. The devil is no fool. He knows the areas that he can attack us, and he does it efficiently. And why does he do this? His aim, of course, is to weaken our faith, which is why it's the shield of faith. His aim is to destroy, frankly, our trust in God and our assurance of God's love. Now, sometimes he uses doubt as the primary way to attack our faith. Unbelief and doubt shows that we lack faith in the power and the promises of God. Unbelief and doubt are twin, you could say, twin fiery arrows that the enemy uses to attack us. When we go, as you know, we talk about this all the time, when we go through the storms of life, the enemy comes to us and he tells us, he says to us, if God really loves you, you wouldn't be suffering in this way. If God really cares for you, then he wouldn't allow bad things to happen to you. Now, this is, of course, a lie. Anybody who knows God's word knows that it's a lie. Some of the greatest saints suffer some of the greatest things. So it's not true what we have to do is think of Job. Nobody that I know has ever suffered by Job. And yet, he was one of the greatest saints of Scripture. So it's a lie. But the devil uses this lie to sow seeds of doubt and unbelief in our hearts, so that our faith in the power and the presence of God is shaken and diminished. He makes us doubt our assurance in Christ. He makes us doubt the love of God for us. He makes us doubt God. He makes us doubt God's word by telling us lies. He did it with Eve and Adam in the garden, and he has never stopped doing it since. He sows doubt and disbelief in our hearts. You can't trust God, you see. He doesn't have your best interest. That's the devil. Another flaming arrow that the devil uses is fear. Fear of the unknown. Fear of the future. Fear of the bad news in the media. Fear. Fear and anxiety are twin deadly arrows of the enemy that he uses to pierce through the believer's soul. And you become crippled by the fear of what might happen tomorrow. You become anxious. You become worried about the unknown future, especially if you've been listening to the news for the last couple of weeks. You're crippled by fear and anxiety. And that's the devil. The devil uses the circumstances of our lives to sow seeds of fear and anxiety and worry in our souls. And what that does, it diminishes our trust in God. You know, I've said it many times here. Every time an angel comes to someone in Scripture, says, do not be afraid. Do not be fearful, because I am from God. We need, therefore, the shield of faith to protect us against the arrows of doubt, unbelief, fear, anxiety, worry, and all the other vulnerabilities in our lives, because the devil knows where your weakness lies, and he will shoot his arrows there. So, what is the shield of faith? Those are the arrows, at least some. We could go on and talk about the arrows, but we want to talk about the shield itself this morning. First of all, understand that Paul says it is a shield. Let's not put the shield up there. It's a shield. Remember, these are metaphors and symbols of spiritual reality. These are not physical things. So what is the purpose of the shield? Well, it is to protect us from the flying arrows of the enemy. The Roman soldier's shield was big enough for the soldier to hide behind. It was originally modeled after a door, we are told. Something big enough to hide behind, but light enough to carry around in battle. The Roman shield is nothing like what we see in Captain America or in these kind of things. Those are little round things that they use. That's not a shield. That's a shield, you see. Something you can hide behind properly. And so, as I said, you know, I found that it was amazing that it was actually modeled after a door. It makes perfect sense. It just needs to be light enough to carry around. Two things about shield, about faith. First, faith is a gift from God. No one can have faith on their own. It is because it is something that God gives to those who seek Him. But nor can you have faith in faith. And I've heard people talk about that. The second point is that faith must have an object. And the strength of your faith comes from the strength of the object of your faith. And we'll talk a bit about that this morning. Jesus said, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you could speak to the mountain and it will obey. The point, sisters and brothers, that Jesus is making is that the size of your faith is not the important thing. Rather, it is the object of your faith. If you have faith in God as small as a mustard seed, you can speak to the mountain. Faith in God can move mountains, because it is not the faith that is moving the mountain, it is God. You see. So using Paul's metaphor, God, in fact, is our shield. And our faith is to be in Him as our shield to protect us from the fiery darts of the enemy. So the Bible uses various metaphors for God as the one who protects us and strengthens us in the battle of life. Psalm 28, verse 7. The Lord is my strength and shield. My heart trusts in Him and He helps me. My heart leaps for joy with my song and I praise Him. God is my rock on whom we find stability from the storms of life. And so when life tosses you back and forth, the rock is the foundation in which you stand so that you find your security in God. And so God is my refuge in whom I can hide from the pursuit of the enemy. Now, David, who wrote most of the Psalms, used these metaphors because he understood, as a warrior himself, the importance of a rock, a place of refuge, a shield, a strong tower, and those things that we've just sung in one of the Psalms we sang this morning. These things were used to keep him safe from the pursuit of his enemies. And they therefore became symbols of our security in God from our spiritual enemy. But these metaphors and symbols will not benefit us if we do not have faith in this God who is our shield, our rock, our refuge, and our great high tower, and so on. It takes faith to put your trust in this God when the arrows of the enemy are targeting at your heart. So what is this faith then? The best definition of faith comes, of course, from the Bible. Hebrews 11, verse 1 is the standard definition of faith. Faith, says Hebrews 11, is confidence in what we hope for, and the assurance about what we do not see. So, faith, says Hebrews, is knowing something to be true and certain, even though you cannot prove it with the physical senses. Faith says, I know this is true, despite what my physical senses are telling me. In Hebrews 11, where the writer talks about faith, he outlined a litany of people who lived by faith. Do read it sometime and see what you find. The one thing they had in common is summed up in verse 13. Verse 13, he says this. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. What is he saying? Abraham, Sarah, Moses, and David, and all the list of people, all died without ever receiving the fullness of the promise that they were promised by God. But they lived in the light of the promise by faith, because they believed that the God who promised is faithful and He will keep His word no matter how long it takes or whether they see the results in their lifetime or not. Their faith, sisters and brothers, wasn't based on themselves. Their faith was based on the faithfulness goodness of God. And therefore they can hold on to that even if they don't see the result tomorrow. And the classic example is, of course, Abraham and Sarah. But they're all there. We will go through them. So faith is confidence in what we hope for and being certain of what we cannot see. Think of Job for a moment. In the thickness of his suffering, Job, we say, was a man of faith. You know, we talk about it, there's an expression, the faith and patience of Job, don't we? He declared his faith in these words in Job chapter 19, verse 25. Listen to what Job says. He says, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. That's Job. Job, sisters and brothers, declared something that he could not see. But he had certainty. And it's about the reality of that. The reality of a resurrection life in God. One day, I am going to see him with my own eyes, he says. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:7, we walk by faith, not by sight. And sisters and brothers, that is the verdict of the Christian life. We live in this world not by what our physical senses tell us, but rather by the promises of God. We do not live listening to the circumstances around us. Our faith is grounded in what God has said to us. And so we live by faith, not by the physical senses. That's what faith is, the shield of faith we're talking about. Somebody says this, and I don't know how true this is, I know nothing about this, but this I repeat it for the purpose of the illustration. This person said that an airplane pilot doesn't fly the plane looking out the window like you drive a car. No, I don't know. I've never flown a plane, so I don't know. Rather, he keeps his eyes on the instruments in front of him. You see, the instruments tell him if he's heading in the right direction or so on. No. It's not what's outside those windows that tells you what's going on. It's the instruments in front of you. And I think it's a great example. We live by what God says, not by what's going on around us. We don't live looking out the window. We live focusing on what God says, the promises of God. The storms of life may be raging around us, but we have the certain confidence, the assurance that God is on our side, and we do not need to fear. The battle for our souls is raging on every side, every day, when the devil shoots his fiery arrows at us. But we are confident that God is our shield to protect our souls and our lives from the evil one. He promises never to leave us nor forsake us. Do you believe this? This is the blessed assurance that we have in Jesus Christ, sisters and brothers. When we have this faith in the words of Christ, then we know that no matter what flaming darts the enemy may throw at us, we are able to repel them with a shield of faith, because our faith is founded on the truth of Jesus Christ. Some time ago, I gave a talk to some Muslims about faith. And I was asked the question, what is faith? And this is, so I got a chance to explain. In explaining, I spoke about faith being knowledge. Knowing certain truths about God is important. But faith is more than knowledge. It is also believing those truths. It's one thing to know certain things about God, but you must believe those things. But we don't stop there, because faith is more than knowledge and belief together. Remember, James tells us that even the devils believe and shudder. So, faith has got to be more than just belief. Because it needs to rise above the faith of devils. Yes? So, I said, faith is also trust. Trust. In the final analysis, faith is trusting God in the darkness. When there is no light, you trust that the God who has revealed himself in Jesus Christ loves you and cares for you and seeks your well-being and your joy in him. He promises that he will be for you. And as a result, no one can be against you. You see? So faith in Jesus Christ is trusting that he is who he said he is, and he has done what he said he's done, and he will do what he says he will do. Two basic analogies that I always use to illustrate faith. The first is a visit to the doctor. When you go to a doctor, they examine you and they write a prescription for you to take to the pharmacist. And they say, you have to take this 3 times a day. Now, most of us simply do what the doctor tells us. We don't question it. We don't say, tell me what's in this thing before I start taking it. I mean, who knows? There might be poison in there. I don't know what. We don't do that. Most of us, I mean, there may be one or two, but most of us, even vaccines and all of these things, we simply trust them. Most of us, I know there are some weird people out there, but there are most of us simply trust what the doctor says because we expect them to have the expertise to know what they're talking about. Right? Sometimes they get it wrong, but instinctively we trust doctors to know what they're doing and that the pills they prescribe for us are going to help us and not kill us. We trust them. We can say we have faith in the doctor because we trust them. That's a form of faith. Another illustration is the very chair you're sitting in. It's a great illustration, isn't it? You assume as you walked in this morning that and you're going to plop down on the chair, it's going to hold you up. You don't feel it's going to topple over and you're going to fall flat on the ground, now do you? Most of us don't look around to see if all the feet are okay and the screws are in place. Most of us don't do that. We just come and sit down. You have faith in the chair. You trust that the chair is going to hold you up. That's faith. Now, the strength of faith, as I said at the beginning, is the object of faith. What you trust in will determine the strength of your faith. We have a mighty God in whom we trust. Our faith is not in ourselves or in any other name under heaven, but in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus Christ. He is strong enough to hold us up. You see, we can sit and be confident that Jesus will keep us safe and we will not fall on our faces. We have a shield of faith to protect us from the arrows of the enemy. Our shield, as I said, is God himself. He's a rock on which we stand as a shield to protect us from the doubts and fears of the enemy. When the devil shoots his arrows of doubt and unbelief at our souls, we have the shield of faith to stand on the blessed assurance of Jesus Christ. The promises that Jesus made to us that he will never leave us nor forsake us and that we are safe and secure behind that shield. When the devil shoots his arrows of fear and intimidation at you, you use the shield of faith to stand in Christ, knowing that he has your future secure. You and I do not know what tomorrow will bring, but we do not need to. to know what tomorrow will bring, because we know, we have confidence and certainty that tomorrow is in the hands of our great and awesome God, and He controls our destiny. He knows exactly what will happen tomorrow, and so we entrust into His hands our lives. And as the psalmist says in Psalm 31:5, into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God. In that same chapter, in verse 14, David says, but I trust in you, Lord. My times are in your hands. Isaiah 41, verse 10. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. That is the faith, sisters and brothers, we have. Doubt, fear, worry, anxiety are attacks of the enemy. Taking up the shield of faith will protect you and allow you to fight back against these attacks. One final point I want to make about the shield. And there's another picture in here that I want to just look at. In the Roman army, this is my last point, when the army comes under attack, the soldiers band together and they use their shields to protect each other. And I find, as I was meditating, this is a beautiful picture of the people of God standing together in faith for one another. Our faith, sisters and brothers, is not just an individual faith. The Christian is never just an individual in the body of Christ. We stand together against the attacks of the enemy. We do not allow the enemy to attack one and the others retreat, run away and hide. No. When the enemy attacks one, he attacks all. And all of us must stand firm with the shield of God, that shield of faith. Together against the enemy, and together we stand, trusting in Him to repel the attacks of the enemy. And so, take up, we have to do it, and nobody's going to take it up for us. It's a command, take up the shield of faith, so that you can extinguish all the fiery arrows of the enemy.
Amen.
Oh God, give us this faith, we pray, that we can trust in your promises, whatever fiery arrows the enemy throws at us today. Give us this faith so that we can be secure in your love, in your mercy, in your grace, so that our faith will not be shaken, because you are our shield. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The song that I've chosen for us to sing is what I've called our theme song, and it's a wonderful song, and we stand and sing it. We cannot sing this song enough. It's our theme song in the morning and evening prayer, when we gather, when we have our prayer time. And so let's sing. Let's stand. Faithful one, so much.
Oh,
unchanging God, whose promises are sure. So there are a few voices as we pray and enter into this time of prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for all the goodness and mercy you lavish on us. We thank you for health, strength, and life. We thank you for abundant health, strength, and life. Grace that you have given us in the death and resurrection of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you for calling us to be your people. Help us to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness as priority in our lives. Give us grace to be faithful stewards of your word and your word, that when you appear, we will hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for your church. Remember your people everywhere as we seek to be the church you have called us to be, passionate for the gospel, proclaiming your kingdom in word and in deed, and helping each other. Give grace to your church to be a faithful witness to the watching world, so that the world may believe in the Lord we proclaim. Remember the persecuted church, all those who even now at various places in our world live in fear because of their faith in you. Protect them from their enemies and give them courage to remain steadfast for Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
We pray for our own diocese, our bishops, Gurley, Lynn, John and Roger, and all other priests and ministers of the gospel, that they may be anointed by your Holy Spirit to proclaim the good news of Jesus, both in their preaching and in their living. May their lives be a living sermon to all, and showing the grace of God through our Lord Jesus Christ. For all your faithful servants, we pray for grace to work together for the growth and witness of your church in our community, so that the world may know that we serve a living and true God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for the sick, the suffering, and the dying. Remember in your mercy, O God, those who are suffering pain and distress, and those who are gifted to care for them. Grant patient endurance to those who suffer, and bring relief and healing from pain. Remember in your mercy those in our own community, and those on our hearts. We pray especially for those in hospital. Remember Sue and Hannah and Daphne. Remember others that are on our hearts today who are suffering in various ways. Remember Muriel. Remember David. And Regine. We pray for Veronica and Chester. We pray for Dory. We pray for Catherine, who had surgery this week. Pray for Hillary, who also recovered from surgery. We also remember those who are mourning the passing of a loved one. Think of Veronica mourning the passing of her brother recently, and another Veronica James, whose brother passed away in America this week. Remember oh God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give them healing and strength in mind, body and spirit, through the precious and powerful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We also pray for nurses, doctors, carers, and all those who work in the caring ministry. Give them patience and help them to serve with love those who are entrusted to their care. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Remember in your mercy those who have become refugees as a result of war and conflict in their own country. Help them to find the welcome and hospitality that they need elsewhere. Thank you for all those who have opened their homes and their hearts across Europe and in this country to help those currently fleeing the war in Ukraine. We pray that you will protect these refugees and help them to find security and help from others. We pray that you will disrupt the plans of Putin and all his generals who perpetrate war against the Ukrainian people. We ask for your intervention in these wars to bring an end to the conflict, for peace and reconciliation among warring parties, and establish peace in these areas, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we pray that your kingdom of peace and justice will come, and that you will break all the weapons of war and thwart all the plans and schemes of those who seek war. We pray for that day when you will judge between the nations and will settle all disputes among peoples. We pray for the day when they will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. We pray for the day when nation will not take up sword or guns or bombs against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. We pray for the day when the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of God, as the waters cover the sea. Hasten this day, O God, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray. Not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Merciful Father, accept and praise. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to him through faith, heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also
with you. Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace. Peace, peace be with you. Peace, peace be with you. Peace. All right, do take a seat if you have an offering. Do put it in the offering plate, and then we are going to say our offertory prayer. And as we did before, as we prepare the table for communion, we will sing Spirit of the Living God, Fall Afresh on Me, a cappella. Let's pray to you. Gracious God, for all you have given us, all you will give us, and all you give us here and now, we offer you our thanks and praise. Bless this offering of our money and of ourselves to be used in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of through your goodness, Lord, we have this bread and wine to offer, the fruit of the earth and the work of human hands. They will become our spiritual food through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord is here.
The Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift
them
to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed at supper with his friends, he took bread. He gave him thanks. He broke it and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, you do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks. And he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising again, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son, Jesus Christ.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, and we lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to call God Father, and so we pray in faith and trust to him.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We bring this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share the one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world,
grant us peace.
Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Jesus died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Amen.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Amen. As you come forward, please do as we make a queue here at the far end of the rail. If you are receiving the body and blood of Christ, then keep your palms open. If not, keep them at your side, and I will offer the blessing of the Lord for you. And we're going to sing two songs, I guess over and over until we finish. From YouTube.
So let us pray at the table of God's mercy. We remember those that are in our hearts that we've been praying for this week. And so we bring before God at this table those that are in our hearts, especially those in hospital. Remember our sister Daphne, sister Sue, and our sister Hannah. We also remember those that are suffering in other ways. We think of our sister Muriel and others in our community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Remember those who are mourning the passing of a loved one. Think of Angela and both Veronica, two Veronicas in fact, Veronica Lynn, mourning the passing of her brother in America, and Veronica James, whose brother also passed away this week. We remember them in our prayers this week. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Gracious God, you call us to fullness of life. Deliver us from unbelief and banish our anxieties with the liberating love of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us and make us continually to be given to all good works through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's say together the prayer of thanks. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. So before we finish this morning, a few notices. To keep in mind this morning. First, just let me welcome back Veronica. Veronica, it's good to see you. Veronica's brother Arthur passed away in America, and she went over to America for a few weeks. So, God bless you. It's good to see you again. I also want to say, Doreen is going over to America as well. Her mother is alive and well, very much alive and well, so she's going to see her mom. So I want to pray for Doreen before she goes. Is today your last Sunday then?
Yeah, I'm going Thursday.
You're going Thursday, so I want to pray for Doreen before she goes. Actually, let's do that now, let's pray. And so, Father, we give you thanks because you are indeed our rock, our shield, our fortress, the one who gives us protection from the storms of life, from the arrows of the enemy. We pray for our sister Doreen as she goes off to America to visit her mother. We thank you for that opportunity to be able to do this. And we pray for her. We pray that you will be with her on her journey. Keep her safe from all harm. Bring her back safely here to us, we pray. And we pray that her time with her mother will be one of happiness and joy. And we ask that you will protect them and watch over their going and coming. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm looking around. That's it. We do have some visitors. Hillary. Her name is Hillary, just to say. Hillary and Tony Ann and CJ. TK, there you go. There's some letters. TK, little TK. Who has baptized here, by the way, just to remind you? I don't know how long ago it was, but she looks grown up, so it wasn't. When was it? It was about
5 years ago.
5 years ago, my goodness, wow. Yes, so they're here to visit this morning, so it's great to see you guys. And for those of you who don't know, they are related to my late wife, so they're related to Nathaniel as from blood. So yes, so it's great to see you guys this morning. There are a few notices I need to just draw your attention to. Keep the shoebox gifts coming in. I noticed the boxes are getting piled up, which is good. That's good. Because we need those items to go in the boxes. And also, if you can get some boxes, I'm sure Georgina would love some more to cover. So if you can get some boxes, I've been asking the shoe zone and those places. You know, every time I go there, they just throw them out. I'm like, seriously, just keep them. Don't just throw them out. You know, keep them for me. You know, yes, Georgina, you're going to say something. Oh, right, to get some boxes. Yes, thank you. That'd be great. Yes. Well, shoes on them, but you know, I got a few from there, but not many. Few other things on your notice sheet. Gift day, our next gift day is the 23rd of October, so do give generously. There are two of them in the year. And the purpose of them is to raise funds, extra funds, for the ministry and for the church and for the community. So do give generously to that when it comes. Tomorrow, there will be a funeral here, and on Tuesday, St. James School is coming by. Year six is coming by from St. James School. They're doing different years going up to Christmas, so year six is coming on Tuesday. One of the notes I didn't put on here, just to keep in mind that it's something that we want to get back to. If you remember, we normally have a bonfire night. And actually, this year, bonfire night is on that night. So it's the 5th of November, Saturday night at the rectory. So do keep that in mind. We wanna resume that because it's a good time of fellowship and fireworks and food. So yes. Andy, you wanna say something?
Okay, those who know me know I struggle with this, and I've been struggling for about a year or so. But the surgeon of the hospital was really, really good. Turned out to be this thing. I've had it since Thursday.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Good testimony. Praise the Lord. She has to take it easy, which she's not doing really well, but but she must. So we will continue to keep her in prayer. She's doing well, and the healing is coming on. We give God thanks for that. All right, that's it, I think, for notices. Let's stand and birthdays, yes. Your mom's birthday?
Yes.
She's 94 tomorrow. Oh, and that's why you're going. Praise mom, praise God, yes. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, listen, I'm going to sing happy birthday to her. Any other birthdays? Una, it's your birthday. Today. Praise God. Yes. See, it's a good thing I didn't forget birthdays. Any other birthdays? All right, we're going to sing happy birthday and pray for these memories for Doreen's mom and for Una. Let's sing. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. We pray that you bless them and keep them strong and safe in your loving care. We ask, Lord, that you make this birthday very special for these, our members, your children. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Yeah, oh, of course. Janetta.
Because yesterday we held our Macmillan Coffee Morning and Mission Sunday. And as we prayed, as Jean prayed for us last Sunday, and with all our prayers, we had a wonderful day. The sun shone in us with all its glory, and everyone rallied around who couldn't make it, gave donations, well wishes, everything. It was just a beautiful day. And we gave a shout of praise in our community to Almighty God, and that's what's important. We had visitors from our neighboring churches, representatives of course, and all of the congregation were there. Who couldn't come gave it good wishes, and everything went very well. We gathered about 500 plus, and there's still promises of more to come in monetary terms. But most importantly, spiritually, it was very upbuilding. So thanks everyone, and let us all give thanks to the Almighty.
Amen. It was a good fellowship, husband. Yes, indeed. You know, these things are needed, sisters and brothers. Just come out and just be with one another. You might spend a pound here and there, but the point is to be with each other and to fellowship on earth. It was a gorgeous day yesterday, wasn't it? Wow, we give God thanks for it. All right, let's stand. We're going to sing our final hymn. Blessed be your name in the land that is beautiful. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ.